Do you feel the shadows deepen? But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? Do you wish that you could see it all?
Welcome, and thanks for choosing Faith Community Church Online today. My name is Nick Sprague, and I'm one of the ministry interns. We want you to know that we've been praying for you, and we've been praying for these services that we're putting out online. We believe that God has the power to change lives through TV screens, computer screens, phones, audio, visual, however he communicates the gospel to you. We're located down here in Osawatomie, Kansas, and we cannot wait to be able to worship with you again. Or when you worship with us for the first time, we are so excited for that moment of human connection and of being together. Know we're praying for you, and I can't wait to see you after the service.
As Jesus and the disciples continued on their way to Jerusalem, they came to a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. Her sister Mary sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he taught, but Martha was distracted by the big dinner she was preparing. She came to Jesus and said, "Lord, doesn't it seem unfair to you that my sister just sits here while I do all the work? Tell her to come and help me." But the Lord said, "My dear Martha, you are worried and upset over all the details. There is only one thing worth being concerned about. Mary has discovered it, and it will not be taken away from her." God, thank you for this reminder of what is important and that you are important. And sometimes we get distracted over things that aren't important. And remind us this week that you are what we need to focus on. Amen.
We're going to spend some time sitting at the feet of Jesus this morning. So if you're able and would like to, please stand with us. We'll sing some songs.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the presence of my enemies, I raise a hallelujah, louder than the ugly. I raise a hallelujah, my weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah, name's a hallelujah. With everything inside of me, I raise a hallelujah. I watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah.
Heartbeat trouble. Hold your head up high, don't fear no evil. Just fix your eyes on this one truth. God is madly in love with you. Take courage, hold on, be strong. Remember where our help comes from.
Walls come down, all creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. All his children, clean hands, pure hearts, good grace, good God, his name is Jesus.
Swing wide, all you heavens, let the praise go up as the walls come down. All creation, everything with breath, repeat the sound. Children, clean hands, your hearts, good grace, good God, his name is Jesus. Jesus, our redemption, our salvation is in his blood. Jesus, the light of heaven, a friend forever. His kingdom come. Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior, isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen.
bow down before him. For he is the
prayer this morning, just the words of Psalms 19. The heavens proclaim the glory of God. The sky displays his craftsmanship. Day after day, the skies continue to speak. Night after night, they make him known. They speak about the sound or word, without a sound or words, their voice is never heard. Yet their message has gone throughout the earth, and their words to all the world. Verse 7, it says, instructions of the Lord are perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The commandments of the Lord are right, bringing joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are clear, giving insight for living. Verse 12 says, and how can I know all the sins lurking in my heart? Cleanse me from these hidden faults. Keep your servant from deliberate sin. Don't let them control me. Then I will be free of guilt and innocent of great sin. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. May the meditations of my heart please you this morning. We just go to prayer and we just take a moment just to breathe a little bit, focus in on him. Again, we don't have an altar to come to physically, but you can make an altar where you're at. Come forward and kneel at the chairs if you'd like. This morning, maybe even just during this next little part of the song, maybe there's something that somebody or you personally would like to be prayed for, anointed with oil for healing. I'd love to pray with you this morning. There's nothing too special about me, but there's something special about the God that we serve. There's something incredible about just taking a step and saying, hey, I need prayer for this. Like I said, you pray for somebody else. God is able to go wherever he needs to go in his spirit. So as we just sing a little more of the song, I just encourage you to connect with him this morning.
We are so thankful that you have given us an opportunity that we can serve you freely. God, we are so thankful that each day that you put people in our lives that you want to shine your love on through us. God, we just pray that you will continue to work in our lives in a mighty, mighty way. Guide and direct as we go through the week encountering you through others. Be with us today as we dig deeper into your word. I pray that you will just nudge our hearts in a way that is meaningful to us. Teach us to love you more. Teach us to serve you more. Teach us to love others more. Teach us to serve others more. We know that there may be some that are hurting and broken within and overwhelmed by getting ready to begin this new school year. Whether it's parents letting go of children, whether it's teachers and educators trying to figure out how to best serve. Maybe it's somebody with a business that's trying just to figure out how to make it survive. God, as we are in this time, we know that we are not alone. That when we come to the end of ourself, all we have to do is to drink from you, to spend more time with you. We get to leave everything behind and look forward to what you have for us. We thank you for sending your Son to die on a cross that we might choose to have everlasting life. God, we thank you for all that you've given to us and all that you have in store for us. Continue to guide and direct us in a mighty way. In your precious name, we pray forever and always. Amen, amen, and amen.
Good to worship the Lord together.
Thank you for your participation. Thank you guys for leading us. And so try not to be distracted while they're going down to their seats, right? Because that's what we're talking about, distraction. I was reading this article in Tech Portal about how technology distracts us in our lives. And just some interesting facts about what happens in our lives sometimes when we become distracted, because, I mean, it's a reality, right? It's a reality, our lives and work and at home and all these places we are, we always have now technology with us. If we carry a phone with us, and most of us do, it's always there. There's always this distraction. And one of the things this article said is that we need to realize that every time we are distracted by technology, it takes about 23 minutes for us to regain our full focus, all right? So if you're working and doing something, and all of a sudden, you know, your phone buzzes at you, you go, oh, I got to look at that, and you're distracted by that, it might take you 23 minutes to get back to really focusing on what's at hand. That's huge for work, right? But it's also huge for conversations with God. You know, I'm praying, and all of a sudden my phone is buzzing in my pocket, and I'm like, what is this? You know, and I've been on this journey. I've been trying to just on my daily story, whatever that is on Facebook, whatever that's called, I don't know, I'm just putting a scripture there wherever I'm reading, I just put that out. But some days I'll be like, oh, and I put that on Facebook, and then, oh, well, what's all of a sudden, you know, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes later, I'm like still on Facebook going, oh, and I'm like, oh, no, that's not what I'm supposed to be doing right now, right? And it's a distraction, and you got to be careful. It's just always there. And then, obviously, this article talks about how distracted driving is not good, right? And so I don't think that applies. But just in case you're like me and sometimes you're tempted to drive with the phone in your hand, don't do that, all right? It's deadly to other people. And so I'm that's just for me. The rest of you, I'm sure, are smarter than that. But if you're not, you know, be not like me and quit texting while you're driving. And I'm working on that. I really am. Much better. Much better than I used to be. Put it in the glove box. Yeah, that's rough. Yeah, and I hate it. I knew I should have just skipped that whole part right there. That was dumb. And we do need to realize that this is a big business, right? That everything that is in technology is there to distract you. That's the point. You know, you don't have to ask apps to notify you, right? You have to tell them not to notify you. Why? It's because they want you to be on that site, on that app as much as possible. That's how they make money. So guess what they do? They try everything they can to get you to go to that and to keep on that. That's the technology that you're up against, and you need to just be aware of that, that's their goal. Their goal is really not to make your life better. That might be what they claim, right? That's not their goal. Their goal is to keep you on their app as long as possible so that they can sell more advertising. It makes sense, right? If I was a business owner and I want to advertise on something, where am I going to go? I want to go to the app. I want to go to the place that has the most people on it the most time. It's a business thing. So we have to be aware of what's happening to us and that it's really an effort and on their part to keep us distracted. And so when we realize that this is what we're facing, we need to say, okay, how do I, as a follower of Christ, learn to meditate? Whatever your distraction might not be a cell phone, right? Your distraction might be something else. But it's either way, we have to figure out how do we truly take time to sit at the feet of Jesus, to meditate on what God's word says. And actually, in our soap, what do you call it? SOAP, what do you call it? Acronym, thank you. In our SOAP acronym, scripture is the first one. Second one is observation, all right? If you like the word observation better than meditation, you know, it works. That somehow it's taking time to just soak in what God is trying to say to us through Scripture. And so I want to read this morning from Luke chapter 24. And this is kind of the end of Luke. Jesus has been raised from the dead, and he's meeting, the only account really that Luke gives us is the road to Emmaus. Jesus meets with two of the disciples. And then this little part here where Jesus meets with all of his disciples, and he says this, starting with verse 44. Then he said to them, "When I was with you before, I told you that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and in the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand Scripture. And he said, "Yes, it was written long ago that the Messiah would suffer and die and rise from the dead on the third day. It was also written that this message would be proclaimed in the authority of his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. There is forgiveness of sin for all who repent. You are witnesses of all these things. And now I will send the Holy Spirit, just as my Father promised. But stay here in the city until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with power from heaven." So Jesus says to his disciples that the Scriptures, the Old Testament that they had as Scriptures, he says, that was given and that had to be fulfilled. He said, it just makes sense that we have this old, what we call an Old Testament in our Bibles, and really that word comes from a covenant. That word is the Old Covenant. It wasn't really, originally, the Hebrew, the Jewish people of the world wouldn't say, "Oh yeah, this is our Old Testament," right? They wouldn't call it an Old Testament. They would call it their Hebrew Scriptures, and so we have that. And Jesus said it was given and it had to be fulfilled in Christ. And we talked last week about how Paul said to Timothy that all these Scriptures are helpful and they're useful in your life because why? They point to Jesus. That's the nature of the New Testament, is that the Old Testament is there, it's valuable, and it's valuable in that it points us to Jesus. It gives us wisdom and understanding. But it is what it is. It is a Scripture that is talking about an old covenant, something that was very relevant, but now it has been fulfilled. And we have to be careful here. I was just reading a book by Andy Stanley called Irresistible, and I asked a former Mid-America theology professor what he thought about it, and he just simply said, "Well, he's a heretic," and I said, "Well, that was helpful," but it's okay. Andy Stanley's not Jesus, and we don't have to believe everything he says, right? And I can learn stuff from his book without believing everything he says. But what I really liked about what he was saying is that this is the old covenant, and Jesus has come, and he's fulfilled it. And it's just understanding the Old Testament in light of Jesus, all right? And you think about so many things that cause people to stumble about the Bible, and a lot of times it's in the Old Testament, all right? A lot of times there are some Scriptures really hard to understand in the Old Testament. And if you take Genesis 1 as a book, science book, there could be some conflict between Genesis 1 and science. There just could be. I'm not saying it is. I don't want to get in that debate today, all right? I'm just saying, we'll wait a few weeks. I'm just saying that, and there's some, some of the prophets that talk about, "Well, I hope our enemy's kids are thrown down into the rocks," that's hard to, what do you do with some of that, right? And so it helps us to think of this reality that the Old Testament was a time where God was trying to build a physical earthly kingdom and in a world and in a time where this is how things happened, right? This was kingdoms and kings, and there's a lot of that. But it still is focusing, it's still pointing to a time of the New Testament. That the new covenant, the new covenant has come. And so maybe we should rename the Scriptures, the Hebrew Scriptures and the Christian Bible as the New Testament, because that's what it is. That's the reality. Now, again, we believe all of it is helpful in helping us have a relationship with God, but we do believe that the New Testament is the new covenant, and once the new has come, what do you do with the old? If you got a new phone today, what would you do with your old phone? You wouldn't keep carrying it around, right? And going, oh, look at my old phone. It's totally useless. See, now we got to be careful because the Old Testament isn't totally useless, right? It's just a fine line I'm jumping on here, and Frank Moore's going to call me a hypocrite, you know, a heretic. but I think there's just some value in understanding that the old, from the right perspective, it's still valuable, it's still important, it's still inspired Word of God. But you have to look at it through the lens and through the understanding that it is pointing us and enlightening us and helping us to understand the new covenant that God gives us. And if we understand it and interpret it in any other way, you can get some really weird theology going on in your life. And it's just, it's difficult at times. And so just to think about that from Jesus saying, hey, there is an old, and everything in the old had to be fulfilled in order for the new to come. However you look at that, however you want to go into that, and if we need to have a one-on-one conversation, I can talk to you about that. Promise, I'm not a heretic most of the time, and I'm just trying to do my best. but to understand God's Word and try to understand the Bible. And Jesus opened, I love that little part of that scripture. Jesus opened their minds to understand. he's saying, hey, I had to fulfill all of this stuff from the old covenant, and then he just opened their minds so that they could finally see, you know, because they're humans, they're like us, right? The disciples, they just had ways and patterns of thinking that they sometimes couldn't get over. They just had ways of thinking about what the Messiah would look like and how the Old Testament was, and they just had different patterns in their heads, and Jesus had to open their minds so that they could understand Scripture. And I think that's what I'm talking about, and I think that's this whole soap analogy, is that once you have Scripture, that somehow you have to say, God, open my mind to understand what you want to communicate to me today. I have met so many people who know the Bible inside and out, have read the Bible inside and out, but it's just a book to them, right? It's not alive and active because they don't ask God to bring it to light when they read it. And it's so important that we say when we read Scripture that we're saying to God, we're asking God, God, open my mind, open this head of mine, this heart of mine, to really understand what you're trying to say. Open me up to all the truth that you have for me. Because if God doesn't, it's just a history book. It's not alive. It's not active in our lives. But if God, through His Holy Spirit, brings things to our mind, it can be so much more. The Scripture can just come alive. And you just think of that. Think about how God will interact with us through His Spirit and through the Word. When God brings us understanding, just think about how that could happen. In a Wesleyan tradition, we talk about how all this quadrilateral of Scripture and tradition and reason and experience. Just imagine how God might open your mind in each of those areas of your life and of your studying Scripture. Again, it starts with Scripture, but then tradition. I mean, and it's important to look at history, right? How things through history have happened and developed. How God has worked in your history, for one, but also just in the history of mankind. If I am reading along in Scripture and all of a sudden I come up with this idea that's just crazy and people would call me a heretic, I need to look at why that is, right? I need to, okay, you know, there's this history behind how this has been interpreted and how this is, and I just don't get to go, oh, well, forget all history. God said to me, that doesn't make sense, right? So when we observe the Bible, we have to take in the context of the history that is there and understand what's going on. We have to understand the reason. God has given us this incredible thing called a brain. All right, it's amazing that you and I have this great privilege of having a brain. And sometimes we just need to use it. Right? Sometimes I wonder about mine, but that's all right. That's a different issue. But God has given us this incredible ability to reason and to think. You are so much different than all the other created beings in our world. And there's a reason that you can think like you can. And it's not an accident. It's a God-given thing. And God wants to use your reason in the right ways. He wants Scripture to inform why you reason the way that you do. And so again, reason can mess you up, right? Logic can send you down the wrong way. But usually the Word of God and His kind of understanding, His kind of logic can form your life. And sometimes God is counterintuitive. I understand that. But He's also very logical because He created your brain. So we think about God, observing Scripture and thinking about God, how does this make sense? How can you enlighten my understanding and my reasoning? And we think of experience. You think about how God has led your life to this point and how God is so consistent with the way that He interacts with people. I love talking to other people who come from other traditions of the Christian faith, especially, and just because I don't have a lot of opportunity to talk to people that come from other faiths, I would enjoy that as well. You know, I'm the kind of person that when the Mormon missionaries come knocking on my door, I'm like, oh yeah, let's talk. You know, I just enjoy it. You know, I'm just like, let's have a conversation. You think about all these different ways, and what I love is when I'm talking to somebody that thinks our theology is just crazy, and then you start to talk to them and you say, well, isn't that the same thing as what we think? Well, yeah. You know, it's just amazing how we think we're so distinct and so unique in this way of thinking or that way of thinking. But man, when it comes to experience, God does many of the similar things. We might define it different. We might talk about it differently. But I think we all experience some of the similar things of faith because God is consistently who God is, no matter what we believe about Him. He's pretty consistent in some of the things that He teaches. And we talk about sanctification or holiness and how you have this deeper connection with God. And we word it in certain ways. And I've talked to so many good Baptists who don't believe in those terminologies, but when we talk about experience, they have experienced the same thing that I have experienced with God. And we might define it differently, but it's still there. It's still this deeper walk, a deeper connection that we've had with God. And I just think, man, it's just how beautiful God is in teaching us about different experiences. And so when we pray, we need to open our minds to the truth and allow God to teach us, and allow God to enlighten us, and take time to pause, to observe, and to let God speak, to let God have time in our conversation. It is a conversation we're trying to have with God, not a let's talk and God listen, right? We really, really want God to speak. And if you really want God to speak, you have to learn to listen. You have to learn to pause long enough to observe what God is trying to say to us through the Word. And Jesus said that the message of the good news has been seen throughout the Bible. You know, He just reminds the disciples that the message of the good news is a central theme of the Bible. You will find it everywhere, that God had planned all along for Jesus to come to the world, to die on a cross, and to be resurrected from the dead. It's the central theme of everything in the Bible. The resurrection of Jesus is the core central theme that all Christian beliefs really, if they're authentic, believe in that one thing. And we might disagree about so many other things, but the good news is the good news. It's the message of Jesus. It's the message of the Messiah that it's just hard to mess that up, you know? I mean, it's hard to not come to that realization that this Jesus was dead and he was resurrected. There's so much proof. There's so much evidence. There's so many good things. You don't have disciples, 11 disciples who followed Jesus and saw him resurrected. You don't see those kind of people give up their lives and the rest of their existence if it wasn't true. You don't do that for a lie. And there's just so much great things about the Bible and about the resurrection that are true, the good news of Jesus that we have. And then Jesus says that he's going to send the Holy Spirit. That it would be awesome, yeah, if you had Jesus sitting in your living room and on your deck with you and just have that conversation, the physical Jesus, that'd be awesome. But in reality, you do through the power of the Holy Spirit. And the reality is you can have as much of a conversation with God through the Holy Spirit as you could with Jesus sitting right next to you at your prayer time. That's what Jesus is saying. Now just let that sink in, right? Let that, how many times have I thought, oh, it'd be so cool to have been one of the disciples and to walk with Jesus and to experience him. And yet, what a cool time it is to live today where the Spirit of God is with you in your heart all the time. That this God who wants to have communication with us is doing that constantly because he's living within us. I mean, even the disciples, I mean, Jesus needed a break from them every once in a while, right? They had to sleep, he had to get away from them. Notice that, right? That Jesus had to go away to quiet places to pray. It's because people are annoying. Right? He was just like, oh, I gotta have some time here. You guys are driving me nuts, right? And so we're so much better off having the Holy Spirit in our hearts on this constant basis. And so we think about praying the scriptures. We think about not just asking some simple questions. When you read the Word of God, and it's good sometimes even just to read a chapter, write one verse down. Write one verse that just goes, boom, what? Man, this verse is just powerful to me today. God is just, and then just start thinking about all the things that go around that scripture. Think about the context, where it is in the Bible and why it's there. Think about what's the situation? What are the things happening in that situation? Who are the people that are there? And what did that first audience, the first people who ever read this story, the people who were there, what were they thinking? And try to get in the mind of the situation and try to see what you can observe, see what you can take time to say, God, what are you trying to say? What were you trying to say then? And what does it mean for me now? And we'll talk a little more about what does it mean for me next week, if you want to come back, if I haven't totally lost you. we'll talk about more about what's the application. But you got to start with what am I observing? Just what am I gaining? What's happening here? And as we think about those things, we think about what are the themes and how does it connect to reason, tradition, and experience, and just let your mind connect with God. Meditate on the Word of God. If you want to hear from God, if you really want to sit at his feet, if you really want to take time and do those things that are really, really essential and important to take the time to be with Jesus, he says you got to meditate on the Word of God. It can't be, I just read the chapter and boom, that was good. See ya. I would say it's probably better to read less and focus more than to read more and not really process it, right? We're going to talk about reading through the Bible in 2 years, and sometimes that's a lot. Even in 2 years, it's not that bad, but sometimes it's 2 or 3 chapters, and sometimes that's too much. And I'm okay if you just say, I'm going to read part of that. It's not a legalism thing where you get extra bonus points if you do it. It's just hopefully a helpful guide for us to stay focused on the whole picture for a while. And I'm excited. I found, as I'm trying to prepare sermon series and things for the next 2 years on this, I thought it would be difficult to kind of fit it, but I found it is difficult, but it's difficult to choose. I mean, there's so much good stuff that we'll be reading, and how do you choose which part I'm going to preach about, which part I'm going to leave out? That's the hard part. I didn't even anticipate that, but there's just so much great communication in the Bible to us. It's just, I just hope you're excited about the Word of God, and once you start really observing, start meditating on it, and it starts coming to life for you, I can remember the days it was just total drudgery to read the Bible. I can remember, man, this, I'm supposed to do this. I mean, I went to camp, I met Jesus. I really, you know, and for 2 weeks I'd read the Bible religiously. And it would be like, oh, this is so boring. I can't stand it. All right, and I quit. When I figured out that God wants to speak to me through it, when I figured out he just wants me to open up and he communicates exactly what I need for that day, it's not a drudgery anymore. It's a joy. It's a heart. I can't imagine trying to make it through my day now without hearing from God. I mean, you know, I like talking to my wife, and we have some good conversations, and I can't imagine too many days. I was gone 8 days, and it was long. You know, I didn't think of it. When I booked it, I was, oh, yeah, 8 days, no big deal. Man, being away, I mean, you got phone, but, I mean, you miss that close conversation. The same way I would miss my time with God now if I didn't hear from him, if I didn't take time to sit at his feet and just allow him to speak. I would just miss him personally, because that's what it is, right? It's this personal connection, this personal relationship with Christ. If it's about reading the Bible, if it's about, oh, you know, this or that, you'll get bored of it. But if it's about this personal connection with Jesus and God's word comes to life to you, it'll be rich and you will enjoy your time in God's word. Let's pray together. God, thank you so much for this day, and thank you for this reality that you love us so much. You want to speak to us. You want to communicate to us. You want to reveal yourself, your words to us. God, you just love to have conversations with your people. You're such a relational God. You want to draw close to us, and you want to draw us close to you. And wherever we're at today in that process, many of us might be really close, and many of us may feel like, God, you don't really care, and you don't really want to have a relationship with me, and I don't really want to have a relationship with you right now. And I thank you that you draw us even in those days, that you're still calling us and you're still reminding us to come close to you. And God, if our lives have gotten to that place where we're just so distracted, would you help us to find ways to just be able to spend a little time with you, sitting at your feet, reading your word, and just observing what you have to say to us. Would we not be afraid of the silence? Teach us, God, that you often communicate to us in a whisper. When we finally turn off enough noise that we hear from you. God, we're grateful that you have given us an opportunity, a freedom to meet here openly and publicly and worship you. You are good, and your love endures forever. Thank you, Jesus. I pray all this in your holy name. Amen. remind you that there's baskets there as you leave. There's connection cards you can fill out, and we can pray for each other. There's lots of needs out there, I know, and lots of people we know that are hurting. And so it just, if we can remind each other to pray and to help each other in that journey, you can do that. Offering baskets are there, or you can give online, however God would lead you. But thank you for your faithfulness in giving. We have a few things going on. We're trying to get our grow groups back rolling Sunday night and Monday. So if you can make it to either one of those tonight, it's at the Hansons, and Monday night it's here. So, and youth are kind of on the family devotions for one more week, and then they'll get back to meeting once I get that Mid-America school started and rolling, and football camp and all that over. We'll see what we can do with that. And then, this is a good one for you, that there's a downtown Osawatomie cleanup August 30th at 7 a.m. They're trying to beat the heat. I understand that would probably be rough if you live a ways away, but I thought maybe we would think about just some of the things we could think about, that once the fall hits, maybe we could. This is the Osawatomie Pride group, and I thought maybe we could just take a Sunday here sometime where when they say, hey, we're going to have a Sunday morning, I could say, well, Faith Community Church will do that this week, and we can worship and then go clean the clean the downtown area. They're just picking up trash and doing those kind of things. So just trying to help Osawatomie look better. But that's, if you just love early mornings and you want to come early that day, you can come at 7, and sounds fun, doesn't it? The other things to pray about, it's an interesting season to think about what we can do and what we can't do, what we will be able. It's hard to plan some things. One of the things I've been working with is Ron Stiles. I don't know if you know Ron, but has an incredible testimony about his son was playing football here 10 years ago and died at the football game. And he has a book coming out this fall, I got together with him and chatted with him, and just like this 10-year thing. And so I'm trying to, we're praying about putting together an event to have Ron be able to give his testimony and to speak in Osawatomie sometime this fall. And that's just like crazy. You know? How do you do that? Where do you do that? And all of those things. But we're just seeking that and asking God to open doors for that. Another thing I was just thinking about was a Christmas smile basket. So I need those creative minds out there to think about what we could put in a Christmas smile basket, just to drop one off at every house in Osawatomie. Just think about those things, how we could, there's a grant that's available. We could get up to $1,000 to help pay for that. So that'd be cool. And so we just have to pitch some ideas on that. And so if you had some ideas, I had some great ideas, and then I realized $1,000 wasn't going to touch that or that or that. So it's the getting an idea that we can afford is a little more difficult than anything. So just think about those things, pray about those things, just the ways that, you know, it's time to say, okay, how do we get to starting to think about reaching out again to our community and inviting people to come in that sense. And so, and we're coming up on our 1-year anniversary of launching, and so think about that too, maybe how we can celebrate that a little bit and be a part of remember that, man, a year. It's the first Sunday after Labor Day. We've been at this a year, and so thank you so much for your faithfulness. So, all right, let's stand together. I'll quit rambling. Thanks for that laugh. No, that's not going to happen. Let's say this prayer together. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. Help me to be still and know that you're in this place. Lord, please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Remind you that we're here to see a movement of God for all people, to experience faith, forgiveness, and freedom. Smile and have a great day.
Lost your cool, then you straight up lost your mind. Tried so hard to stay ahead, but you keep falling behind. Life is gonna pull you down, make it hard to see. But a little change in your point of view could be just what you need. There's always a reason to always choose.
Thanks for worshiping with us online today. We cannot wait to worship with you again, or better yet, we can't wait to worship with you in person. We have a few things we want you to do before you go, though. We would love to converse with you and be able to meet you, or however you want that to look. You can message us on Facebook at Faith Community Church of the Nazarene, or you can shoot us an email at ozfaithchurch@gmail.com. We also would like to connect with you. We have our connection card online at ozfaith.net, and it's underneath the connection tabs. Then, last but not least, if you're willing or you're one of our regular attenders, we have a giving platform online. It's safe. It's easy. Just go to ozfaith.net again, and it's under the giving tab. Again, we can't thank you enough for being able to worship with us, and we can't wait till the next time we get to meet.